You have written substantially about M.Visvesvaraya, and mostly people know him as an engineer who constructed things, right? Built dams and so on. But you have a different perspective of him. Could you tell us more about that?
See, he did start his career as an engineer, no doubt about it. But over a period of nearly 80 years, his working life was very long. He came to distinguish himself as an innovator, as an administrator, as an industrialist, and as an economic thinker, and above all as a statesman. He's now been rightly recognized as the father of planning in India. In his Planned Economy for India, which he wrote in 1940, is a comprehensive economic survey of India. And in that, he has suggested 5-year plan for the British India and 10-year plan for native Indian states to double their economy respectively in a period of 5 and 10 years. So he has given a clear roadmap how we should go about it to double India's total economy in 5 years' time so far as British India was concerned and in 10 years native states were concerned. That is the reason why he is considered the father of planning in India, and his Bharat Ratna citation also clearly mentions that.
But the concept of planning is frowned upon these days, right? The concept of planning is thought of as being this top-down socialist mindset. How does that compare with the plan that Visvesvaraya had? Was it socialist thinking, or how was he different?
He was not a socialist. In fact, he did not want, he wanted minimal government interference in business. He suggested, kept on suggesting that to Nehru. Nehru did not take his advice. Sarabhi taught industry was essentially the concern of the people, and it was government's job only to facilitate, create an environment where industries can flourish, and that would take care of poverty. He always told Nehru, government getting into business would lead to profligacy, and economy, growth of economy would be slow. So in that context, you could define him as a capitalist. He was not a socialist. Sarabhi always made it very clear, distribution of wealth comes only when we have wealth. So it's government's job to ensure that people who have the entrepreneurial spirit generate wealth first. Then wealth automatically trickles down. One doesn't have to really struggle much. I'm a multi-billionaire. If I spend my, you know, $1 million on my daughter's wedding, it is trickling down. You know, who is fixing a bulb somewhere. It trickles down. Wealth cannot stay in one place. Otherwise, there's no fun. A wealthy man has to spend it. Otherwise, it makes no sense for him to keep the wealth. So the government should essentially, you know, create the environment where wealth is generated. There are fewer restrictions, so the industries can flourish. This was Sarabhi's advice to Nehru. I just read out a few things, you know, interesting things from how Nehru and Visvesvaraya differed in many respects. Just let me read this from a book. Here there's a chapter called Visvesvaraya and Jawaharlal Nehru. Visvesvaraya wanted the establishment of heavy industries. He wanted the construction of huge dams and irrigation canals. He wanted the establishment of a central statistical agency that could aid and assist a central planning commission. Towards the end of his long life, Visvesvaraya came to see all his ideas being materialized. One could almost say independent India under the Prime Ministership of Jawaharlal Nehru came to realize Visvesvaraya's dream of a modern industrialized India. In fact, H.V.R. Iyengar says this in so many words. He attached the utmost importance to industries, particularly heavy industries. Here he means Visvesvaraya. The ideas he then propounded were almost exactly in line with the current policy of government. The central point in his thesis was not merely the need for setting up large-scale industries, but the paramount necessity of the state taking an important part in the process. This observation, in my opinion, is completely not correct. It was just, you know, perhaps written to please Nehru. But in reality, Visvesvaraya had serious differences with the Nehru government. So far, what precisely were the reasons for Visvesvaraya's disagreement with the Nehru government? The principal reason was that Visvesvaraya was at heart an admirer of America, the United States of America, and American capitalist economic policies. He was not too convinced about socialism as an economic doctrine. He believed that socialism, which tries to regulate and control the individual, would end up in authoritarianism, which is detrimental to economic well-being of the state. He was not a great admirer of Soviet Russia either. I'm quoting Saddam V. Soviet Russia's ideal of economic democracy is stated to be based on rewarding individual initiative in direct ratio to the approximate measure of productivity. But there is no information available to convince the people of fair play. He was very clear in castigating Soviet Union policies. He further states, Saddam V states this, having regard to the conditions prevailing in India, it is safe for this country to proceed along the lines practiced in such capitalist countries as France and the United States of America. India resembles France in small size of the agricultural holdings and the United States in large size of the country and the magnitude of its resources, particularly manpower. We have yet to build up some measure of moderate industrial prosperity, and for the present, capitalism is the best suited for this purpose. Only the monopolies incidental to capitalism should be minimized, and wherever they are inevitable, a watch should be maintained and special modifications made by legal enactments and otherwise in the direction of service to the public. It behooves the state to refrain from enacting any legislation to limit legitimate private enterprise, and at the same time to ensure that large capitalist undertakings are carried in harmony with larger interests of the great mass of the people.
So, Visvesvaraya was a fan of the United States, and you also mentioned that he was a fan of Japan.
Yes.
And he wanted India to emulate this. He was very keen on getting statistics. He was also very focused on heavy industries. He thought that could modernize India. So could you give us a little background on this?
Saddam V was opposed to one thing. He did not want to accept this truism that India economy is largely based on agriculture. Saddam V said, India's economy is based on agriculture because we don't have industries. It is not some virtue. It was a fact of life, yes, but that had to be changed. People in rural areas had gainful employment hardly for about 3 months a year during harvest, and when they actually plowed the lands, before monsoon for sowing. These were the 2 months they kept themselves busy. And the remaining 9 months almost, they did not have any employment. And they did not have great prosperity either. So because of that, lack of amenities, lack of even ambition became a virtue in this country. So Saddam V thought, so many people in villages doing so little should be pulled out of villages. We should go for rapid urbanization, industrialization, so that the masses in villages find gainful employment. And agriculture industry anyway doesn't need so many people.
So, Sir M.V. Visvesvaraya it is fascinating that such an early time he was for urbanization and industrialization.
Urbanization and industrialization, because he thought that was the only way the country could come out of poverty. And when it came to industrialization, again he was very clear, as I just read, capitalist model of economy, no government interference, allow industries to function, create an environment where industries and industrialists can function smoothly without too much of interference from the government. He was very clear about these two. That precisely he kept on telling Nehru, don't have too much of interference, don't create public sector enterprises where that takes government money and nobody becomes accountable for anything that happens. And now we have come to see how public enterprises failed one after the other.
And this was in the 1950s?
This was in 1937 when he wrote his Planned Economy for India, not 1950s.
Oh, so even before independence he was pretty...
Before independence, yes, he told all this, mm-hmm. Before independence. See, Nehru, on the other hand, was a dyed-in-the-wool socialist and a great admirer of the Soviet Union. He opted for excessive government, imposing, as he did, too many restrictions on the growth of the private sector. As Rajagopalachari put it, Nehru put license quota permit Raj in the place of British Raj. Visvesvaraya was no doubt all for setting up heavy industries, and he knew that heavy industries could not be established without investment from the government. I am quoting Sir M.V. Heavy industries are a necessity to raise the people's standard of living and for many other important developments, for defense, for nation building, for civilization itself. If heavy industries are rapidly developed in India, railway locomotives, rolling stock and plant, army machinery, ordnance and stores may be easily manufactured locally instead of, as will be seen from the earlier chapter, the country having to import them from Great Britain or foreign countries to the extent of rupees 25 to 35 crore every year. See, even today, India is importing, you know, lot of defense equipment, including, you know, warplanes and all that, at a huge cost to us. If we only had taken Sir M.V.'s advice, built up this infrastructure ourselves, we would be saving billions of rupees today.
And it was Sir Visvesvaraya's initiative that also led to the establishment of Hindustan Aeronautics Limited.
Yes, as well as, you know, the automobile factory.
That's, yeah, could you give us the background on those two?
That's actually a very fascinating story. I just let me go back to refresh my own memory here. I want to say both about automobile industry and aviation industry.
So Visvesvaraya was responsible for the creation of
absolutely,
automobile and aircraft industries.
It's a statement that is 100% correct.
Yeah.
See, the fact that India had inadequate roads did not deter Visvesvaraya from thinking of establishing an automobile factory in India. All the cars on Indian roads at that time were imported. If a foreign car maker found India a big enough market to sell their cars here, could not Indians manufacture cars in India itself, was a question. It was with this thought in mind that Visvesvaraya visited automobile factories in Britain, Italy and America and collected the required data, both technical and commercial, and he wrote a detailed report on the feasibility of establishing an automobile factory in India. The report that was first published in 1935, it's called an automobile factory for the Bombay province. It generated considerable buzz, and it was said Walchand Hirachand, a well-known industrialist from Bombay, expressed his interest in establishing an automobile factory in India after going through Sir M.V.'s book, his monograph. At Visvesvaraya's insistence, the Bombay government offered some concessions to Walchand Hirachand and placed at his disposal services of Mr. B.P. Advani, the director of industries in the Bombay government, to help him negotiate a suitable agreement with either British or American automobile manufacturers. Walchand Hirachand and Advani proceeded to the USA, contacted the great Mr. Henry Ford himself, and also Sorensen, whom Visvesvaraya had earlier met. Henry Ford found the idea of collaborating with Walchand Hirachand feasible, and having convinced themselves as to the commercial aspects of the proposal, Ford and Walchand Hirachand finalized the terms of collaboration. Advani then negotiated an agreement with the Ford company for technical assistance to the Walchand Hirachand company in India.
Who is the Advani we are speaking about?
He was the director of industries in the Bombay province. Having finalized the agreement, Advani sent cables to the government of Bombay and also to Visvesvaraya, informing both the finalization of the agreement. At this stage, the Ford company realized that they had an agreement with the Canadian Ford company under which the Canadian company had the sole say in the manufacture and sale of Ford cars in the entire British Commonwealth, and India was part of that. The Canadian Ford company, on being contacted, refused to transfer the technical know-how or to collaborate technically with Walchand company unless it was allowed to hold 51% in it. As Walchand Hirachand did not accept this condition, the negotiations fell through. Subsequently, Advani then contacted the Chrysler Corporation in Detroit and held negotiations with them. They too formed the scheme of collaboration with an Indian company commercially feasible and agreed to provide technical support as well as the know-how to the Walchand company for the manufacture of cars in India. On finalizing the terms of agreement, the Chrysler Corporation and Walchand Hirachand returned to Bombay and established the Premier Automobile Company. At this point of time, the Government of India, whose consent was required to establish automobile industry, refused the consent.
So incredible. The British colonial government
did not want Indian industrialization. Because, you know, for them, India was the market. They did not want industrialize India.
So they stopped even a car company
car
from...
They stopped it. And subsequently, they stopped even the aeronautic company. Then what actually then was, Visvesvaraya then said, if the British don't give the permission, you set it up in Mysore. Mm-hmm. Because Maharaja was there, Prithviraj Wadiyar was a great king. And they came to Mysore. Mirza Ismail was the Diwan then. And he was also a very progressive thinker. And he was all for the establishment of an automobile industry in Mysore, in the state of Mysore, in the kingdom of Mysore. But the British put pressure on the Maharaja not to allow the establishment of the factories here, even in Mysore.
But so this is not told in our history books?
It is not told. Unfortunately, it is not told. So the automobile factory, you know, the idea had to be cold stored for these reasons. Maharaja was not allowed to permit these people to establish the automobile factory in Mysore, and British government refused to give permission. And in spite of you know, the entire council of ministers telling Maharaja give the permission, such was, you know, the hold of the resident over the Maharaja's administration, Maharaja could not give permission. At the end of the day, Maharaja had to listen to the crown. He had limited powers. Aviation industry also came about in a similar way. When Advani was proceeding to Detroit, you know, to negotiate with Chrysler Corporation, on the plane he met one aviation expert. I think his name is Before the aviation industry came into existence, we needed the infrastructure, we needed the airports, we needed training school to train pilots. And this is where, you know, Sir M.V. strongly advocated, you know, establishing such things in his book, Planned Economy for India, as early as 1940. He writes this in his book: no achievement of man has ever made such progress in so short a period as man's conquest of the air. India, the country of long distances, has, by its geographical position of focal point of aviation for Central Asia, has been drawn in to take an important part in this development. So he went on to tell the government to establish the landing facilities for small aircraft, air taxis, in major municipalities of India. He said, you set aside the required money for establishment of airports as well as training schools. And he forced the government, you know, to do something about it. For example, in 1934, the Standing Finance Committee of the Indian Legislative Assembly approved the proposal for the development of air routes in India. And these proposals involved an expenditure of 92,57,000 spread over 3 years, of which aerodromes and landing grounds will absorb about 76,70,000, and wireless facilities about 10,21,000, and remaining 5,66,000 will be employed in improving meteorological information now available for pilots. All these, you know, certainly is initiative, you know, the government, then government wanted to create this kind of, so by the time, you know, the aircraft factory idea came in, sort of India was sort of partially, developed enough to have the aircraft industry to be established in India. And, you know, then there were two airline companies were in operation. One is the Imperial Airlines, operating on the South Karachi, Delhi, Calcutta, Rangoon route, and the Tata Sons Limited, operating the Bombay Karachi route. So Visvesvaraya was, however, never too much of for government. So he advocated government investment in industries only as the last step, when adequate private capital investment was not available. So he said, when Valchand Hirachand is not willing to establish an industry, allow him to do that. You don't get into it. And then for the technology, actually what actually happened was, while on his way to the USA to seek technical collaboration for the automobile industry, Advani happened to come in contact with one Mr. P.W. Pauly, who was an American aircraft expert. When requested, Pauly was good enough to give a scheme for the establishment of an aircraft factory in India.
So this is in the 1930s.
Valchand Hirachand, who found the scheme interesting, forwarded it to the Commander-in-Chief in India for permission to establish an aircraft factory. Having applied for the permission, Valchand Hirachand reached an understanding with the Mysore government to establish the factory in Bangalore with Pauly as the technical consultant. When no response was forthcoming from the government of India, even after sufficient lapse of time, Valchand began to think that the aircraft scheme too would go the automobile scheme way. That is, the government,
British government wouldn't allow.
But then something happened. It is the Dunkirk disaster. While the British government in India sat on the aircraft scheme, the British and the French army suffered heavy casualties at the German hands in the Battle of Dunkirk.
So this is the beginning of the early World War II.
And during the period, that is May-June 1940, the Allied troops lost so many men, equipment and ships and aircraft that the Allies almost thought, you know, they had lost the war. That disaster made the British government realize the importance of having an aircraft factory outside Britain, and then consented to the establishment of the aircraft factory in Bangalore.
So basically the losses in World War II led to the establishment of...
It was called Hindustan Aircraft Factory, and subsequently Jawaharlal Nehru nationalized it, and HAL, Hindustan Aeronautic Limited, came into existence. And even today that is the only aircraft factory in India. So this is, you know, the role Sir M.V. played both in the establishment of automobile and aircraft factory in India. This is the book I've been reading from. This is my book on Sir M.V.'s economic contribution and thought. See, as I told you initially, people know Sir M.V. as an engineer, but he was much more than that. As I put it in my own book, to describe Sir M.V. as an engineer is like describing the sea as a vast body of salt water. The description is accurate, but it is hardly adequate. Sir M.V. was much more than that. I just read to you, his role in the establishment of aviation industry, automobile industry. And he is the father of planning in India. In fact, it is his book, Planned Economy for India, which he was published in 1937, that launched me on this literary journey. When I read it, you know, I was really amazed at the extent, you know, of his economic thought, the spread and as well as the depth. He had such clear views about, you know, how to turn India's economy around and make India economically strong. And some of the ideas that he advocated then have contemporary relevance. Even today, we can put them to practice with considerable benefit. He advocated three things: rapid urbanization, lesser dependence on agriculture, minimum government interference, complete encouragement to entrepreneurs to establish industries. These were his four mantras. After liberalization, thanks to Narasimha Rao, you know, government of India to a great extent accepted these policies, and you know what actually happened after liberalization, Indian economy grew. There was no reason for us to wait till 1980 for Narasimha Rao to come into the scene. If only Nehru had accepted these ideas, implemented them, India would be a major economy today. Anyway, we missed the bus then, and let's hope that, you know, it'll at least things will improve from now on. I'm a builder, and a construction site is a lonely place after 5 o'clock. That is one of the reasons I carry a lot of books and keep reading. I've written about DVG, I've also written about certain things, you know, other things, for example, partition and other divisive issues. I've written about, secularism and national identity, how, you know, we mix up certain concepts to our own detriment. I have discussed all these things. Next book I have in my mind is, I want to write about Savitri, Aurobindo's poem Savitri. I found this to be extremely fascinating and I want to write about it. It's a mystic poem, very long poem. I want to write about it.
When do you plan on, what is your goal on it, or when do you think
well,
we can read it?
I have no specific goal, because as I told you, I write only when I have time. Writing is, I write to relax, because I also feel the urge to share what I read with other people. You get the sudden urge, you read something and you're so fascinated by it or you're so intrigued by it, you would want to share it with other people. For me, writing is a process of communication, to share my own sense of wonder with other people, my own sense of joy with other people. That's the only reason why I write. And let me see, this has been bothering me, the idea of writing about Savitri. Perhaps it will happen sooner than later.
Sreenath Avare, thank you very much for writing this wonderful book about Sarveshwarya. We look forward to your upcoming book on Aurobindo's as well.
Thank you so much. Nice of you. You pulled so much out of me. Thank you so much. For long, I was intrigued by this Satyam Tvartena Parishanchami. Every time we offer Naivedya, we sprinkle water and say Satyam Tvartena Parishanchami. I always wondered what it meant. Ruta, as we understand, the simple translation of the sentence is, I am sprinkling Satya and Ruta. Ruta, as is generally understood, is the cosmic, that is what we call Ruta. That is the common meaning. And one day I happened to lay hands on DVG's Ruta Satya Dharma. That gave a very clear understanding of this profound sentence, Satyam Tvartena Parishanchami. He says in this Ruta, in this Satyam Tvartena, he is the antonym of Anruta. Anruta is something that is not true. So as an antonym, Ruta means true. That was its original meaning. Subsequently, it got changed to cosmic order. So when we say, I am sprinkling Satya and Ruta, it is saying, you know, if Ruta also means Satya, then it amounts to saying, I am sprinkling Satya and Ruta, Satya. So how is Ruta, if Ruta is truth and Satya is also truth, how are these two truths different? DVG's book very clearly explains that. He quoting Sayana, you know, he says this. Satya is the part of truth that we, part of reality that we intuitively, that we perceive through the senses. I see a cup of water there, I feel it, I see it, I touch it, I understand something about it. That is the part of reality that I perceive through the senses, that is Satya. And I also, without actually seeing it, I also perceive something about it intuitively. This intuitive perception of reality is Ruta. So unless we combine these two, we cannot have a complete holistic idea of reality. So that is the reason why we say Satyam Tvartena Parishanchami. A very complex thought, very beautifully explained by DVG. Much later, I thought of another book I had read earlier. It was called Human Destiny by Lokomte Du Nui. Lokomte Du Nui was a Nobel laureate and he was a biologist, got Nobel Prize in medicine. He has written this book called Human Destiny. His argument is more or less the same. You take, for instance, ash and wheat flour, you mix it to get a grey powder. But imagine a microscopic organism moving in that. It sees only black and black and white powders. So on the microscopic scale of observation, there is no such thing as grey powder. So given the vastness of the cosmos, even with the best of our tools, the best of telescopes, what you can think of, the best of microscopes, we are like that microscope moving in, we cannot have a complete picture. So to get a clear idea of that ultimate sense of reality, we must approach it intuitively, the way, you know, the sages did ages ago. So again he says, you know, as a great scientist, as a complete reliance on experimental verification will limit our knowledge. Because experimental verification has its obvious limitations. To get to deeper truth, we must rely on intuition. This again comes back to Satyam Tvartena Parishanchami. I mean, that's why I yesterday used the word serendipity. This is serendipity, the thing that had been bothering me for such a long time. I happened to come across two books that explained the same thing so beautifully. Ruta Satya Dharma and Human Destiny by Lokomte Du Nui.
So what I would say is, you mentioned the first one by DVG. Now, DVG was not just an author or a scholar in that sense, right? He had a huge picture. He was a builder of a nation, and his ideas were asked for by great people. So could you tell us something about that aspect of DVG and how he contributed to the of India?
DVG's contribution is intellectual. It is not seen. He did not build dams. He did not, you know, erect a huge monument anywhere. It is completely intellectual. But that it will be there, like a subterranean stream, always nourishing the minds of India. That's an extremely immense contribution, not visible but very important.
So what you are saying is, he helped the intellectually the builders who later on built.
He did lay the foundation. The Gokhale Institute, for example, is basically to train people in the art of politics. Mm. So he was being an intellectual. And his contribution is to the empire of the spirit. That was his immense contribution. That's why he's not very visible. But the few people who came to be influenced by him subsequently could contribute a lot more to society because they were influenced by a man like him. That is his immense contribution. Mm. It is not readily seen. Mm.
Can you give us examples of who those people were and what they did?
Countless. For example, was influenced by this.
Kengal Hanumanta was the former chief minister of Karnataka.
And K.C. Reddy. Mm. All these people, in a way, you know, they were all students of DVG. More recently, Lakshmi Sagar was a minister in Ramakrishna Secretary's government. Mm. He was a disciple of DVG. And countless academicians from V.K. Gokak, who was a Jnanapeeth awardee, so many of them, they all, you know, came under DVG's influence.
Even Sir Visveshwaraya was influenced by DVG too.
I wouldn't say he was influenced by DVG because Visveshwaraya was much older. Mm. But Visveshwaraya recognized DVG's qualities and tried to, you know, put it to service of society. That was Visveshwaraya's greatness lay in recognizing DVG's greatness and tried to encourage him because Visveshwaraya was much, much older than DVG. Mm. But he recognized DVG's spark in DVG. And he thought DVG's immense potential he recognized. So I can't say Visveshwaraya was influenced by DVG, but he had a great deal of affection and subsequently he developed a lot of respect for DVG. In spite of their huge difference in age and in stature, in terms of popularity, in terms of their financial success, there was a huge gap between DVG and Visveshwaraya. But that did not stop from Visveshwaraya recognized greatness and encouraged him to the extent that he could. In fact, when the organizers of Native People's in Princely States Conference in Trivandrum.
Okay, could you state more, give the background on what that was?
See, the freedom struggle spearheaded by Bal Gangadhar Tilak and subsequently taken over by various other people, Gokhale, Ranade and also Gandhi, Nehru, they all jumped into the fray subsequently. It was all largely confined to the British, that is the areas ruled by the British people. But apart from the British Raj, we had innumerable princely states. Mm-hmm. They were not directly administered by the British, but the kings were there, subjects of the king, like Mysore. Mysore people were subjects of the Wadair dynasty. So these people had been left out of the freedom struggle. A lot of political thinkers in these princely states, could be Trivancore, could be Mysore, they also wanted to be a part of the mainstream political struggle, so that eventually when the British left India, even these people got back their constitutional rights. They did not want to be subjects of a monarchy anymore. They were also wanting a responsible government. The rest of India, the British India was clamoring for. So all these people, the people, you know, the thinkers, political thinkers in these native states, they came together and they wanted to organize a conference to exclusively discuss the problems of the princely states of India in the political context, which I just explained. So the conference was held in Trivandrum. That was in the year 1940s, if I am right. I'm not very sure of the period. They approached Sir M.V. to be the chairman of that conference.
Sir M.V. is Sir M. Visveshwaraya.
Visveshwaraya. So Visveshwaraya said, you know, he would accept the responsibility only if DVG was willing to assist him to be his secretary. That was the respect and the trust he had in DVG's intellectual ability. DVG by then had already written a book called, it's a very popular book, The Problem of Native Indian States, which had received an excellent press, acclaimed by many thinkers, including Sir Shiv Swam Iyer, Subramanya Iyer, and all those people of, all those people, they had praised it immensely. It's a very, very beautiful book, clear analysis, like all other books. So DVG became a part of that, and that memorandum that came out, the conference called the Trivandrum Memorandum, later became very popular, and it became the basis of the second roundtable conference. So this is, that's why I said DVG's contribution is intellectual largely, and in the context of Sadhambi, we saw DVG's ability and tried to make use of it.
Mm-hmm.
So that way these two people, they did go together.